So I like to give people a challenge to go the next 24 hours, don't express any displeasure with anything. Mm. Not the traffic, not the weather, nothing that you can't do anything about.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Hey, John, for anyone who's ever said something they've later regretted, this is going to be the broadcast for you. We're going to talk about how to tame the tongue. That's probably one of the hardest things to do. And of course, it's not the tongue. It's just the deliverer of the message. It's our hearts and what our minds are thinking about the world around us. And God wants to get control of that for very good reason. We are reminded throughout the Bible to do everything without complaining or arguing. That mandate in and of itself could take us a lifetime to accomplish. You mature over time. In the Christian community, we call that the sanctification process. And, you know, with God's help and the Holy Spirit's guidance, we can improve substantially in that area to take control, take captive that nasty tongue, and actually bless people with it rather than curse people with it. Mm-hmm. Here at Focus, that's what we want to be to you. If you struggle in this area, we're here for you. Call us. We have counselors. We have resources like Deborah's book, 30 Days to Taming Your Tongue. And that's an area, if you need help, we're here.
And Deborah is a certified public accountant, a Bible teacher, a speaker, author of a number of books. And Jim, you mentioned that 30 Days to Taming Your Tongue. I think this is perhaps one of the most convicting topics we've covered on this broadcast.
It will be. Wait till we cover it. Deborah, welcome back to Focus.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited about this topic.
It's so good to have you. You know, one thing, and I want for our listeners to better understand, I was so impressed with your resume, and I'm not going to read everything, but you graduated with an MBA from USC there in Southern California, former VP of MCA Universal Studios Venture Capital Division. You are a finance person, aren't you?
I'm also a former maid who made 75 cents an hour, so let's get that in there.
That is awesome. I love that. But, you know, just everything that you've done, you've gone through the John Maxwell training, leadership certification. You just have done so much. You are a high achiever.
I like learning.
Okay, that's good.
I like learning. I think it's good for you, good for your brain, good for your attitude about life. I'm always looking forward to something.
I love it. Is your husband similar in that way, or how does he manage your life together?
We're complete opposites. We look differently, and we always say we're as different as we look.
Okay, so this is good. So how do you tame your tongue when it comes to your husband not behaving the way you want him to?
By taking heed. I love what the psalmist says. He says, I will take heed to my ways, that I sin not with my tongue. But I had some good mentors, and one of my mentors always told me, she said, now listen, that tongue of yours, you're going to have to really pay attention to it. So she said, always stop, think, and pray before you say something. I'm like, that's a lot.
Yeah. And this book has sold over a million copies.
Yeah.
Why do you think people have resonated with your message?
Well, first of all, I think it's because God took a mess and turned it into a message, because I wrote the book
because
I messed up. I mean, it's an accidental book, but I don't like to use that word accidental when I'm talking about the things of God. So I'm going to say it's a providential book. But I really messed up and told something I wasn't supposed to tell. And I wasn't being indiscreet. I was just trying to rescue somebody. And it backfired. I was trying to help somebody out, blah, blah, blah. It backfired, and she was so upset with me. I decided to go on a tongue fast myself. I'm going to put myself on a plan for 30 days, and I'm not going to say anything negative. Now just try that, all right?
So this was for you in the end.
It was a personal project for me only.
I appreciate that vulnerability, because a lot of people would say, yeah, I wrote it for a friend.
No, I wrote it for me, and people kept, and I would put signs in my office at work. It would say tongue fast. That means when you come in here, don't discuss anything negative. I'm on a tongue fast. If people started to be negative, I say, I can't discuss that. And so somebody said, I believe God wants you to write a book. No, I believe God wants me to work on me.
Okay.
So
this really is capturing that journey.
Yeah.
And
absolutely.
What you did.
Yeah.
Now, why are we so broadly, why are we all so affected with tongue problems? I mean, it's so natural for us in our flesh to lash out, to say things we regret. Why?
Is because we are human. And also because we're not created carbon copies of each other. And so we don't always know other people's sensitivities. You know, you may jokingly say something about my dark skin. You may not know that I am just like, oh, don't say that or whatever. You just never know what people's sensitivities are. And so you are bound to offend somebody.
Yeah. And even though you're challenging us for 30 days, you started to say, you know, just try it for 24 hours. I want you to finish that challenge because
okay,
I think you're going to say it's hard.
I was going to say that at the end, but I'll say it now because don't think you can do all 30 of these tongues that I've listed in the book. I have 30 negative uses of the tongue.
So one for each day.
Just try one a day or just try one a week.
Yeah.
Just, for instance, if you have trouble telling the whole truth, you tend to tell half the truth. Just say, this week I'm going to tell the whole truth and nothing but. I'm not going to imply something that's not true. Here's an example. I tend to run late for things sometimes, and I'll just come in. Now, in L.A., you know, I rush in and go, ah, traffic.
Yeah,
now, I didn't say I was in traffic. I didn't say I was in traffic. I just said traffic. Half truth. My husband said, listen, the half truth is a whole lie.
Wow, that's good.
Yeah. And so, but see, you see subtle ways that we can like not tell the truth. And so we all have negative uses of the tongue. So I when I started this project, I said, I'm going to look up every negative use of the tongue I can find in the Bible. I'm going to find scriptures for them. And then I'm going to put a challenge out there to refrain from it. So that's what I did.
Yeah. And that's good. And we're going to cover some of those. Yeah. One is the know-it-all tongue. Now, the people that are the know-it-all people just went, no, don't cover that one.
So, we already have this one. Move on to the next, please.
What is the know-it-all tongue?
Where you just can't even receive from anybody else, but every subject that comes up, you have the final word on it. Even if you're in Bible study and there's been a great lesson laid out, and you'll say, but what we have to really remember above all, it's like, no, we don't. That's not above all.
You even have the vocabulary for this.
No, really. Or here's a funny thing. When we're buying a car, because I deliberately like to let people teach me things, I just think it makes them feel better.
Especially if you already know it.
If you already know it. And see, that's a big challenge.
That's
it's hard
to do.
To let, especially for a man.
Yes. You want to be the teacher. I've been here, son.
Yeah, yeah.
Let me show you how to change that tire.
So sometimes when we're buying a car or something and they'll talk down to me because I'm the little woman, I think it's so funny because I am a CPA and they'll explain that, you know, with interest, you know, the payment has interest and principal. I think that is so funny. I have an MBA in finance. I can do an amortization schedule in my head. And I'll say, okay, and I'll just act like they're telling me something.
It's hard to bite your tongue in that case.
Well, but if you choose to, because let me tell you why you want to do that. It's pride. You don't want anybody to think you don't know something. It's this fear of appearing to be inadequate.
Yes.
So no, I'm adequate. I know that already.
Well, now, what about the know-nothing person? And I'll put myself in that category. I'm horrible with fixing things around the house. I really am. So I'll go to one of the, you know, big stores, Home Depot or Lowe's or one of those. And I'm pretending that I actually know how to fix this spring in my door or something. And I'm lost. I mean, I get home and I eventually got to call somebody to come and fix it for me.
And why do you pretend?
But sure, that's a pride thing.
Why?
Like every guy should know how to fix this broken toilet. And
should.
I'm going, no, I don't. But are you like that?
So I had a situation at home where our sprinkler system needed repair. And I called and I got somebody to come over and do it. Could I have done it? Yes. But what I told my wife is, this is cheaper. Because this guy will do it faster and he will save me parts. And he did. Afterwards, it was like, he saved me a $27 part. I didn't have to buy
it. What's funny for me is I've got, you know, when you go through that, you buy all the tools you need for the job. Then you can't do it and you call the person and they do it. And then you still have all these
cheaper,
tools
Jim,
in the
just
garage.
Do it.
And it's okay to say, I don't know.
Yeah, that's the point I was getting at.
Right. And so I challenge the audience to do that. Be quick to say, I don't know. Because you know what? People like you when you're more vulnerable. They connect with you better on your vulnerabilities.
Well, that's true. That's true. I think for men, it's hard to say, I don't know, if I could be blunt. It's hard to say that. And that is something we got to get over.
And there,
I'm working
there
on
are examples
it.
Of it in the Bible.
That should be the one, the 30-day challenge of saying, I don't know.
Yeah,
that's what I'm
going
to do.
Yeah,
what
okay.
about in marriage? How does this know-it-all tongue tend to play out in marriage?
Well, I tell you what my mentor told me when she said, when I was engaged to Darnell and she was in the car with us one day, we were discussing something and she said, okay, Missy, we know you're smart, but don't know everything. She said, let him
that
know some
good.
Things.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, yeah, I plan to let him know some things.
Starting right now.
Right, starting right now. But I took that to heart. Let him know some things. You don't have to jump in there and say, I can do that. And so I'm pretty good at being vulnerable. It just helps.
Yeah. But it's a maturity in Christ to be able to bite the tongue and say, okay, I don't have to straighten him out every time.
You don't have to straighten anybody out. You don't have to tell somebody, I know that, or, you know, you just don't have to do that. That's pride. And you
well,
got to
there are teenagers, though. You might want to straighten some of them out.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Now, okay, now the argumentative tongue.
Oh, boy.
Oh, is this one hitting a little spot?
No, I grew up in a family
there?
That liked to argue. I have relatives that arguing is their norm.
Okay, so let me ask that. So your family of origin, how you grow up, could shape some of these tongue
maladies.
Absolutely, because
you could become like that, or you could become the complete opposite. I decided I didn't want to be argumentative because I just thought an argument should have a resolution.
You're right.
Not just keep going in a circle, because that's how my parents argued. And they just, I never saw them really resolve something and say, okay, from now on, this is how we're going to go forward. It would just become circular. They just go into the next level of an argument. And I just think when people do that, it's because I think they're maybe feeling insecure about what they do know. Yeah. Why do you need to argue that? I have a brother who likes to argue the Bible. I don't argue the Bible. I just tell you what part I embrace, which is all of it. And if you choose not to, that's fine.
That sounds pretty definitive. But it's true, and I can understand that. I think you can create an environment of arguing,
yes.
And some people might even say that's a positive because you want to be able to stand on firm ground. You want to be able to defend your positions.
And you should. You should be able to defend your faith, but you don't have to be mean about it.
Well, that's true.
Yeah, you know.
I totally believe
because
that.
Because I think that's what's wrong, even in politics. This last election just split a lot of relationships.
Sure.
And I'm thinking, I'm friends with everybody. I embrace everybody's right to believe what they want to believe. I don't. Why do you have to believe the way I do?
Yeah, but there's a certain intolerance, a growing intolerance in
there
the culture
is.
In this regard. And it's both left and right.
It is too bad. It's too bad, yeah.
Well, okay, that's a good place to put that argumentative tongue. What about, again, in marriage? Let me apply this here. When you have the spouse, and mm-hmm. I'm not going to say it's the wife or the husband,
right.
Just the spouse, who is just constantly picking a fight. What do you do? What if you're the receiver of that? What advice do you have for that spouse to say, honey, can you stop chewing me up? I'm not processing at your speed. You're just killing me here.
Well, I think you need to agree quickly with your adversary.
Yeah, right.
As the Bible talks about, agree quickly with your adversary. So if my husband and I are in a discussion, I will say, I hear you. You see, I don't give any fuel to that. I'll say, I hear you. If he's putting forth a point, and if I don't, I hear you does not mean I agree with you. It means I literally hear you.
Right.
But that helps.
But it reduces the friction.
It does, because half the part of resolving an argument mm-hmm. is for that person to feel like they've been heard and you're validating their point. So I hear you will do that.
Huh.
I hear you. And then I can say, we can just agree to disagree. That's
yeah.
what makes us so unique. We're different.
There is, I think generally when people say, I hear you, they do hear you. There is
yeah.
the occasional time when the right. person being told, I hear you, knows you're not listening.
Well, you got to listen, though.
So it has to be
You listen with your
sincere.
Eyes and your expressions. You listen and you nod your head.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Deborah, the complaining tongue. I mean, again, these are societal problems right
yes.
now. We seem to relish complaining.
All of us.
Yeah.
It's contagious.
Yeah.
And we got to be sensitive to it. That's why I call this a fast, where you become keenly aware of your tendency to engage in these negative behaviors. And complaining is so natural. I don't care. You can be in a market and everybody's, here's a good example, in the bank. Oh, the line is long or whatever. And for people who still go to the bank,
yeah, I was
going to
say, do you go in
banking.
The bank? I don't
well,
think I've
some
been
people
in the
do
bank
that,
in
you
years.
Know, you know, like in years, you got to go there. Or I have
the lines
to send,
are too long.
I have to send money often to relatives in distress. So you have to go to Walmart or somewhere stand in that
okay.
line. I hate it. But, you know, but the complaining is like, oh, and I'm thinking, you're standing here because you have access to resources. Do you know that half the world lives on less than $2 a day?
So the half
yeah.
full cup. You
right.
Know?
So, yeah. But here's the deal. You got to become aware of your complaining. And I think that we could actually park on this and spend an hour talking about it because it is so easy. So I like to give people a challenge to go the next 24 hours, don't express any displeasure with anything.
Mm.
Not the traffic, not the weather, nothing that you can't do anything about. And in the scriptures, the psalmist says, I poured out my complaint before the Lord. If the person you're complaining to can't do anything about it, stop talking.
Yeah, I like that. I think we should, the Focus on the Family Facebook page might be a good place to have you post where you failed and where you succeeded.
Yeah, just 24 hours.
Go to the Focus on the Family Facebook page and let's see how people do with the next 24 hours, if you can do this.
Right.
go for it and let's see what people's experiences are. I struggle with that. I mean, Gene and I get home and, you know, something's gone wrong and I'm complaining about it. So I'll fess up my 24 hours as well. So we can all take a look at our achievement.
And it takes your joy. It takes your joy away. And as a Christian, that's not the image we want to portray. That's not the example we want. We want to be people who bless the Lord at all times. The joy of the Lord is our strength.
Here's one that's funny for us. I remember when I first started Focus on the Family. It was 1989.
Wow.
That is a long time ago. And I was on a training mission with another person, and we were out, and we went to a rental car counter to get the car. And they had no cars. And Ooh. It was just out of a comedy, you know, situation. And so the person who's training me from Focus on the Family was kind of upset, you know, with the agent saying, well, I reserved a car. Why wouldn't you have a car for me? And, you know, it was a little heated and, you know, are you going to get a car? And the person finally brought all the information up on the screen and they said, oh, Focus on the Family. I love Dr. Dobson. Oops. Focus on the Family. And this person went, oh, great. That's so wonderful. I mean, their tone changed like this.
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
and that was a great lesson for me to bite my tongue, you know, when on an airline problem or a rental car problem, I'm trying to always behave myself because you never know when they're going to say, oh, I listened to you on the radio.
Okay, now, lest I sound like a walking Bible, let me tell you, this is what keeps me from complaining. Romans 8:28, all things are working together for my good. Now, it may not look like it, but if I stop and tell myself that, this delay is working for my good. This traffic is working for my good. God is protecting me.
That's a hard one
to
believe. Come on.
No, really, I do it. I do it.
This traffic's working for my good.
This traffic, I mean, you know, and I don't care if I get up there 2 miles later and see an accident. Well, that could have been me if that car hadn't cut in front of me and slowed me down. You know, so we got to believe that.
It's a good way to look at things. Yeah. Let's go to the self-absorbed tongue. I mean, that's tough to say with your tongue, but the self-absorbed tongue. What are you describing there?
I'm describing a person who's always talking about himself.
The me monster.
They're not interested in you, you know, and what you're about and your dreams and hopes. They're just talking about all the wonderful things that happened to them. Oh, my book, 30 Days to Tame Your Tongue, has sold 1 million copies, and I'm in Denver doing 6 media interviews, and I'm just me, 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 me.
Can I ask you, though, at the core of that is deep insecurity.
Deep insecurity.
So there's more stuff going on there. So how does the person, let's again go to the spouse. You're married to that person.
Okay.
How you've noticed this. You obviously said yes. But how do you begin to say, honey, have you ever really just recorded what you're saying? Have you ever heard yourself and what you're saying? How do you go about helping each other grow?
I would take the sandwich approach. You always say something positive, then you give them the meat of the matter. And you can say, listen, I just love it that God has blessed you in so many areas. He's just caused you to achieve in so many areas, or so many great things are happening. Are you aware of the fact that other people may not be as blessed, and it may not be very endearing to them to hear all about you like that? And so you might want to focus on other people. Ask them questions and show them how to do it. My husband and I, and he's not self-absorbed, but as part of networking, he's learned how to ask people questions and be interested in others.
Yeah.
Because you know they say everybody's favorite subject is what? Themselves.
Yeah.
So I like to focus on other people. I don't want to just focus on me and what I'm doing. I like to ask them questions. You know, so tell me about your background. Where did you grow up?
Yeah. And it's so, people love to engage and
they
talk
do.
About themselves.
And we got to watch that so that we listen to it and be genuinely interested
now,
in other.
Here's the greatest challenge on earth when you have children. And especially, again, I'll just go to the teen years. That's an important parenting tool. How to ask questions of your teenager.
Yes.
And really thoughtful questions, not how did school go today? Because that's grunt. Yeah, good.
Right. Yeah, even if you ask them, who's your favorite teacher? Why? What do you like about her style?
Yeah.
What teacher do you not like the most? What do you not like
and
about
And why not?
That? Yeah.
And then don't be judgmental about
don't
it.
Don't be judgmental.
Well, that's a great
just
teacher.
Listen.
Yeah, you need to learn math.
Yeah. Listen.
It's fun.
Two ears, one mouth. Listen.
There you go. You also mentioned a moment ago the half-truth tongue. I really appreciate all these wonderful tongue twisters that you give us. The half-truth tongue. Elaborate on that a little bit more. I like that idea of prevarication is what the scripture calls it.
Well, we don't think we lie, do we?
No,
let's just
not
call
a
it
full
what it is.
Lie. It's just a half lie.
But as my husband said, a half truth is a whole lie.
Yeah, embellishing.
But I used to be the queen of that. I would just tell half the truth. If I had to take off from work and take my mom to the doctor, I only needed like 4 hours, but I would just take off the rest of the day. Because like, I had to take my mom to the doctor. I did take my mom to the doctor. It didn't take all day.
Do you think... I'm saying that because I think in the Christian community, we really pour ourselves into this one because we think we're getting away with it. But the Lord sees that and he doesn't want that. He wants us to be honest and straightforward. I guess the question then becomes, are we a culture that struggles with honest and straightforward?
We struggle with sin, period. And if we're not conscious of it, which is why I like for people to go in these 30-day periods of abstinence from certain things, because it sensitizes you to where you are. You know, and we all have areas of our tongue, especially, that we could be less critical, we could be less a whole bunch of things. And so if we tend to tell half the truth, understand that it's displeasing to God. And if you want to read a story just kind of like that with Ananias and Sapphira, who sold their land in the book of Acts, and they said, because everybody else was selling land and donating it, it was such a culture there that everybody was sharing, and they said, yeah, we sold ours, but they told a lie. They did sell it, but they lied about how much they sold it for. They kept back part of it, and God struck them dead.
I think a lot of people that read that go, wow, that's pretty harsh.
That's pretty harsh, but I think God was setting a precedent to say, listen, this, we're not going to tolerate
these. Don't mess with this.
Yeah. Yeah. No, we need to tell the truth. Foundationally, we need to base the church on the truth.
Back to what you were saying, though, about your own experiences. Why were you telling half-truths about taking your mom to the doctor or something?
Oh, because I was trying to mislead people. Listen, any lie is an intent to deceive.
But for what purpose?
Because I wanted them to think it took all day so I could go do something else. I don't want to say I took my mom to the doctor for 3 hours and I spent the other five shopping.
Okay.
This is a really tough one. Is it ever reasonable to just, you have to tell the whole truth really every time?
You don't have to volunteer the whole truth, but if you always have to look at the intent of the heart. If the intent is to deceive, meaning I want you to think something different than what the reality is, then you are lying.
Yeah, and that's what it is.
It is. See, if you just call a spade, then you can just go in and be healed.
Yeah.
You can't be healed of things you conceal. You really can't.
Now, in that context of encouragement, it's so fun. It's almost like giving a birthday present when you can be an encourager.
Yes.
But again, just personally, that can be a struggle at times because you're feeling like we need reprimand, we need course correction, especially if you're in management, you're leading people, you have kids at home. There are times when you have to be helping them see the path.
And giving them hope rather than punishment.
Well, giving them hope, but sometimes it might be punishment.
And an expectation, though, that I know you can do better than this. And there may have to be a punishment, but you don't leave it with just that.
Well, and I just want people to make, and me, to hear from you that, course correction is okay. God, that's truth. And
that's
something that God wants us to do to encourage each other. Even Paul writes about that, to finish the race strongly, to rise up to the right standards.
And whenever you can, encourage rather than criticize. And I think that is just so critical because it impacts other people's progress. When you read the story of Miriam in the Bible where they criticized Moses and then God struck her with leprosy, the whole place came to a standstill. They couldn't move. Nobody could move forward. And I say that's a lesson there, because when you are critical like that, it really impedes other people's progress.
Right.
And so one of the things we can do, and in the book I talk about the fact that not only should you refrain from these 30 negative uses, but find 30 ways to be more positive. Encourage somebody to say, yes, you can do this. Let me tell you a story. I have a friend whose husband is very mean. And I called her one day and I said, I just want to tell you that your merchandise is good. I was studying Proverbs 31. And I said, she perceives that her merchandise is good. I want to let you know that you have good merchandise. And she said she kept that message on her phone for like forever almost.
That's amazing.
Because she wanted to hear
just that little bit
validation.
Of encouragement.
Yeah.
Yeah. What kind of trigger do you use? And I guess for temperament reasons, you have a more negative temperament to a more positive temperament. So the more positive person, it's going to come more naturally.
Yeah.
So speak to both of that. What kind of trigger do you use to say, I'm going to bite my tongue. I'm not going to say that negative thing I thought of. And you're doing this in milliseconds.
Yes.
And you're going to say something positive and encouraging.
Right.
What trigger do you use to make sure you...
Well, here's my trigger. The Holy Spirit will often tell you, don't say that. It's like a caution light. He's like, okay, you need to stop talking. You're about to mess up. And then sometimes, and I have to tell you, sometimes I run the light. I violate it. Especially if somebody's not doing a great job. And I hate this because I'm thinking that's not brain surgery. And I've actually said that, but I didn't know what a negative impact that had on somebody. To one of my former employees, he lied about his qualifications and he couldn't do the job. And I looked at it one day and I said, that's not brain surgery. How hard is that? Well, that's like saying idiot.
That's a cutting remark.
Yeah, and I didn't realize
that. But I could be right with you.
But it wiped him out. I didn't know that. I'm thinking, well, you shouldn't have lied about the job. The least I'm going to do is give you a tongue lash and you shouldn't have lied about it.
Again, a lot of people are going to say that was reasonable, Deborah.
No,
why are you beating yourself up? I know, but some people will say, so how do we need to interpret that it wasn't? Because there's a logic to that, too.
The tone, the put down. When you say everybody knows that, what are you saying? Except you, idiot.
Okay, so let's back the tape up.
Let's back the tape up.
Play that forward how it should have
been
done.
And I said, okay, he didn't post the receivables right when I was working as a CFO at this place. And I said, now I you know, I shouldn't have said, how hard is that? I'm going to say, what aspect of this did you find confusing? Because I could use that as a teaching moment right. rather than a moment to beat him up.
And you don't add this, it obviously right. confused you.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. You said, what part of this did I not make clear?
That is so good.
What part
though.
Do you need more clarity? I could ask that question if I'd stopped, if I thought about it and prayed about it before I said it. But sometimes you're so frustrated when you're so goal oriented. And that's why when you are a high achiever, you have to watch your tongue more yeah. probably than anybody else.
Well, and you think about that, the immediate response is, wouldn't this be a better world? But think of this, wouldn't it be a better church if
yes.
we had these principles down? Talk about the retaliating tongue, because that's one we need to cover here at the very end.
Yes.
Because it's so easy
yes.
to fall into that spot.
And especially in marriage, because you know, retaliate means to return the punishment.
So you're keeping score.
Yeah, you're keeping score. And if he says something, I'm going to say something. Why do you need to return the punishment rather than seeking first to understand?
So I will win, Deborah.
No, but have you won?
No, in the end, you lose,
right. you lose
everything.
You lose because words never die.
Right.
And that's what we have to remember. Words never die. They're going to last like they're going to be like shrapnel in that person's brain. So you don't need to return the punishment. You need to seek first to understand. Why don't you turn that into an opportunity to say, could you explain more what you mean by that? And even if it was mean, the person said something that was mean, you need to say, you know, your tone really hurt me.
Yeah.
It's okay to be vulnerable and to say that those words really hurt me. And I really wish you would think about it next time.
If you think about this, what's so good is this applies to every area of your life,
every
in
area.
Your marriage,
yeah.
in your parenting, in your work relationships, in your friendships. I mean, this is a secret to living a blessed
Absolutely.
Life
and
words, a good life.
Words frame our relationships. So whether we're at work, our words, you can encourage your boss and become one of his favorite people.
Oh, you will.
You
That's
will.
For sure.
Try it. It works. I've done this. My husband the other day, I said, you know what I like about you? And he's so used to me being positive for a reason. He said, is this a setup for you to ask me a question?
There's a list coming, right? Right? Saturday's list is on its way.
He said, I don't know
fix
about you.
Fix the door. We're back to that, John.
Yeah,
fix the door.
No. Just call somebody.
Right.
Deborah, this has been so good. And it is so practical. This is probably one of the most practical things we've done in a long time. I also love your 30-day challenge. And let me read a couple of these really quick. Did I engage in any form of lying? Did I flatter someone? Did I manipulate someone? Did I speak too hastily? What a great list. And maybe with your permission, we could post that for people
Absolutely.
To take a look at it.
Yeah.
But get a copy of Deborah's book, 30 Days to Taming Your Tongue. It is a quick read. Let me end with this, Deborah.
Okay.
How do I know I'm making progress?
Because I have a checklist. That's what that checklist that you read at the
so
end of each day.
So if you can go through and say, I didn't do this,
I didn't do this. And I have to tell you that one day I did it and I had five violations.
I was going to say, it's hard not to have something on there.
I had
there.
Five and I go, Lord, we got to do better than this. I'm the author of the book.
5 out of 30 is pretty good. Isn't that an A?
Well, no.
So have you had times when you've looked at that and it's been clean? You said, no, I can't.
No.
So you never, okay,
no,
that's
even
good.
If I've been hasty. It's
okay,
like,
that's good.
Okay, that
so
was hasty.
5's a little much for the
yeah,
author,
right,
but for
right.
the reader, maybe 5 would be a great start.
Just do the best you can with the help of the Holy Spirit.
You are positive. Deborah, thanks for being with us.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Hey, I'm John Fuller, and thanks for watching. Get more info about Focus over here and more from our guests over there, and be sure to subscribe to our channel as well.